Welcome to the Difference Project, an exploration into how to use difference to make a difference. And in this first season, how to use the diversity of thought and ideas that comes from different backgrounds, perspectives, and lived human experience to diversify the future of work. And what we're seeing is the new normal in that future is one where change is faster and more pervasive than ever. One where it seems that a world is getting noisier and more uncertain every day. One where the ability to cut through the noise, to respond quickly to change, or to be resilient when change upsets your apple cart is becoming even more important than the ability to plan and execute. And often we respond by trying to be louder than the noise, by being reactive in our decisions, by being more directive in our leadership. It's exhausting, really, both for leaders and for their people. But what if a quieter leadership approach allowed you to shut out the noise rather than shout above it, to make better decisions about the long-term future of your enterprise? Wouldn't it be great if giving the quieter voices in your organization an opportunity to be heard allowed you to create a workplace that met your people's needs and was good for business, without having to sift through all the expert advice about hybrid working spaces and great resignations? How amazing would it be if you learned that these quieter people had an inner strength that made your workplace more resilient and had thoughtful insights that allowed you to be a more adaptable organization? Now, I know there's some of you out there saying that when the iguana hits the propeller, there's a need to be directive, to be reactive, to make quick decisions. Of course there is. There are those times. But in today's show, we want to use the experience and insights of our panel to explore why it doesn't need to be the default leadership choice. We want to encourage you to see beyond your beliefs and biases about how a quieter approach is too passive, and that quieter people don't have leadership skills or value to contribute. And with that, let's meet our panelists. I want to start with my producer, co-host, and co-conspirator, Mike Emmett. Mike, good day. How are you, my friend? Welcome back for another exciting
episode. Thanks. It's always good to be back for another episode of The Difference Project. Thanks for continuing to believe in this with me. It's your baby, and I'm really pleased to be here for the ride. And I think we believe in this together. So, you know, go us.
Excellent. Perhaps we should kick off by recognizing the traditional owners of our land that you and I get to bring this from. And
as we always do here at the Difference Project, we acknowledge that for Jeff and I, the traditional owners of this land are the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and we pay our respects to their elders past, present, and emerging.
Cool. In our pre-production discussions, you said you were particularly excited about this episode's themes. Why is that? What sort of ground are you hoping we'll cover today?
Yeah, so, you know, I knew you were going to ask this because I asked you to ask me this. And and then this thing happened at the top of the show where I got to absorb that dance piece and just listen and watch. And it was incredible. And I thought, that's why we need quiet people to actually hear and listen and absorb those things. And so off the back of quite a profound experience right at the top of the show here today, I'm just going to say, wow.
Oh, cool. Well, that's, the same. I think sometimes we're told that leadership is about talking more or louder, particularly in those times that are difficult or challenging or disruptive. But I think oftentimes leadership is giving voice to other people. And it's defined by our action and the autonomy we create. So today I'm excited because we have a couple of new panelists with us. And so we'll start out by welcoming Megumi Miki to the Difference Project as founder of Quietly Powerful and the author of a book by the same name. Megumi helps leaders unlock the individual and collective potential that exists within quieter voices. So good morning, Megumi. How are you this morning?
Good morning, Jeff, and thank you so much. And Thank you for taking that time to show the dance piece, because I was quite moved as well, mainly because my daughter's a dancer. She's a ballet dancer. And one of the things that I see of dancers, particularly ballet dancers, but also in that contemporary piece, is that that is what quietly powerful is. You don't have to say a word and it's so expressive. And in fact, they are so, so powerful. If you knew what goes into becoming a ballet dancer, it is like, you know, some of them are stronger than football players kind of thing. So you just don't realize that quiet equals powerful, can be powerful. So I'm just so delighted that you showed that at the beginning.
Oh, that's excellent. Excellent. It's, I actually, yeah, I've watched it a number of times now, and I still struggle with it because of where it came from for me. So.
Oh, wow.
Cool. So I guess one of the obvious questions for you is, what does quietly powerful mean to you? And maybe you've just shared a little bit of that, but when you talk about it, what is the connotation that you generate in your mind?
Yeah, there's lots of connotations, if you like. The reason why I started to talk about quietly powerful is to really dispel the myth that quiet does not equal powerful, which is often what we think of. Yeah, so when you see somebody quiet, I often say this in presentations where you say, you know, if somebody's talking about Megumi and, you know, her work, and let's say it's a performance conversation, and somebody says, oh, Megumi's a really good performer and does really good things, but she's been quiet. You know, what do you think of? And, you know, all these words come up about not being confident, she doesn't know enough, or, you know, doesn't contribute, or whatever, all sorts of words come up. And that may be the case. That's definitely can be the case. But there's also, if you remind yourself of people who may not say a lot, but when they do, they're incredibly wise and powerful, there's the other side as well. And so I really wanted to bring that to people's attention. And I know your other guest, Paula, I interviewed a bunch of quietly powerful leaders who show that. And I really wanted to showcase that, to say, actually, particularly as you said at the beginning, in this world of uncertainty, perhaps that's the kind of leadership we need more of.
Yeah, cool. Great. Thank you, Megumi. I'm excited to get stuck into it, actually. Our next panelist is Paula Giles. And Paula is a board director, senior executive, and management consultant specializing in the intersection between strategy, governance, organizational development, service design, and change management. Welcome to the Difference Project, Paula. It's a pleasure to have you.
Yes,
and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeff. Look, I'm really surprised and delighted. It's a fabulous opportunity to hear about the work that you do, but also to reflect on some of the experiences and observations that I've had over the course of my executive career, and how my views and perceptions of leadership have changed, and what I now regard as looking around a room of people, particularly in a boardroom, where you get the better value of the contribution to the meeting and the discussion and the issues. And I often observe that it's the noisy kettle that has less to offer, and the task is to ensure that all the voices are heard and to elicit the clarity of thinking that you need to make sound decisions. And if there is something around leadership, whether you're, you know, in the quietly powerful domain or in the extroversion part, it is really your task to get the best of the people in the room at the time, and not to fall into the trap of always allowing the noisy person to speak and grab the airtime.
Cool. And this intersection between strategy, governance, the organizational service design, change, it's a fascinating one for me. And is that sort of that idea that you're talking about? Those different intersections need to have a different sort of voice?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, governance has a particular, you know, responsibility, you know, when you're sitting with the hat of a director and your obligations as a director, but also ensuring that you've got all of the right structures and organisational, processes in place. The service design, I think, is a really interesting way where you're beginning to think outside in to make sure that you've got the capacity to respond to needs of your customers or parties, suppliers, etc., and that you actually have the formal and governance structures, decision-making, organisational forms to best accommodate that. And it's often a quite a tension and, a difficult dance where you want to be customer-centric, but, you know, we've got these, you know, policies and practices that maybe mitigate against that. So there's a lot of that do as I say versus what, you know,
Absolutely. Excellent. Well, I'm so excited to get stuck into our conversation to see where some of these things take us. So, Mike, perhaps you could kick us off with our first question, my friend.
Sure, Jeff. Look, you know, I was worried that there was going to be four quiet people in a meeting and we would just sit here and listen to each other. But, you know, I think here we are, and, you know, I make these jokes at my own expense. So the first question that we have is that there is a popular perception that quieter, more reserved people are the same thing as introverts. Do you believe this is the case?
No, not for me. it can be. And I think, this is something I wrote in the book, actually. It's in one of the chapters where why is somebody quiet? Well, there's lots of reasons why people can be quiet. One of which is, of course, naturally being introverted. But some introverts are also quite gregarious. I don't know whether you've realised. Some comedians, you know, some actors, some people who can actually be quite gregarious, but they just need a little bit of time out on their own to recover. So there's definitely that. But there's also, interestingly, when I was starting to speak about quietly powerful, I assumed that most people would be introverts, and I realised they weren't. And I'd say about a quarter of people who've come along to my programs have been extroverts. And we know this because we do a personality profiling as part of the program. And what I understood then over time is that actually it's people who have what's called high emotionality can also be quiet. And what that means is it's people who really intensely feel the outside situation. And so they feel quite anxious, for example, sitting in a group of people. Even though they're quite extroverted, they can go quiet, or it could be that they're highly sensitive. They feel a little overloaded by the different scenarios going around them. So it's just sensory overload. But the other thing too, and this is very relevant to your work, Jeff, in this difference project, when somebody's very different to the majority, it's quite difficult to speak up. Yeah, so if you're, and I've experienced that lots of times, of course, being an Asian woman, often in a male-dominated environment, it can be quite difficult. So for women in a male-dominated industry, that can be difficult. I'm sure Paula could probably talk about that. But also, even if you look the same, if you have a different opinion, it could be difficult. And I'm wondering, in board meetings, Paula, you might find that too, where somebody has a completely different idea and it's harder to bring that up because everybody else is going to go, oh, no. So that could be the case as well. So there's a whole bunch of things. It could be upbringing too. You know, of course, having a Japanese background, that can also play a part.
Yes. Thank you, Megumi. I was just thinking about the question before I lead into the question you raised. I don't think it's terribly helpful. I think that's the point you've made, Megumi, about the labels of introvert, extrovert. And I'd really prefer to focus on the behaviour, which is what you've done. Because I think the labels just, you know, put you in a box and aren't sufficiently contextual for the circumstances that people might be in. So I get a bit irritated by that notion of, you know, introversion and extroversion. I know it's helpful, you know, for labels and to provide some degree of self-awareness. So I'd rather focus on the behaviour. My observation has been there are people, and I'm probably doing it now, that gush, speak too much maybe, and the effectiveness of what they have to say is lost in the volume of the words and the noise. And it's partly, I think, Jeff, what you're referring to in your introduction, that the moment to reflect and say less actually has greater impact than the volume of the words and the and the amount of the words being expressed. And I've certainly found around a board table that there will be people who don't say anything for a variety of reasons. Politically, they don't wish to. Another, they have no opinion. The matters that they felt were issues have already been raised. So again, that's quite contextual and specific, not necessarily because they are naturally quieter people. So I think it's very important not to be too driven by the labels, and then particularly around a board meeting, to not go over the point unnecessarily if you know, there's a consensus and a view of the way in which we should proceed.
I think one of the in creating these labels with introverts and extroverts, the other misleading thing is you don't sit in one box or the other. It's a whole spectrum, and that spectrum really is more around how you feel about a social environment, how much you crave a social environment, as opposed to how much you interact and speak and how loud you are in those social environments. You know, very quiet people can like being amongst other people. They just don't have to be the life of the party, so to speak.
And I think over time one becomes more functionally capable. You know, I know that I am naturally an introvert, so here I'm labelling myself. But the nature of the work, you know, requires, and one just becomes more adaptable. You know, the workplace or the environment in which you find yourself is a sociable place, because we're sociable beings and we get things done through and with other people by and large. So I think you build up a reserve of capacity to respond and manage and deal with highly sociable situations. And, you know, that's the circumstance I'm in now. You know, a lot of, you know, functions that I go to, but my capacity to deal with that, I think, is much better than I was when I was 24.
I would add, actually, if I may, that when you have a sense of purpose behind why you behave, how you behave, that can also help as well. So I, for example, I don't particularly like being on a TV show like this, or being on stage in front of, you know, 1,000 people, which I have done. But because I feel so strongly about this work and I really want to help people who feel disempowered by being quiet, that purpose drives me to get myself out there. And, you know, so it's not like I do it because I want to, or I love to. I do it because I feel the need to, because of the purpose.
I completely and utterly relate to that movie. I'm a forced adventurer when it comes to being in front of large groups of people. Mike, I think this is actually a pretty good segue into our next question, if I from memory.
So, yeah, quick shout out from the audience over here. Richard Hodge would like to say hello to Megumi. Nice to see you again. And we have a comment from Peter Maguire, who suggests that psychological safety is a really important aspect to the way that we allow quiet leaders or leaders of any kind to emerge. So yes, with that, our the next question is what are some of the qualities of quiet people?
Can I comment on the psychological safety thing, because it's come up? One, I think it's very helpful to have quiet psychological safety for quieter people to speak up, but actually it's also space. So I've been working on this idea of leaders who listen, who create the space and space safety to allow people to speak up. So you can have all the safety in the world, you know, people feeling very comfortable to speak up. But if one or two people dominate the conversation, the quieter people, because they feel they can't jump in, or they're quite polite and so they don't feel like they can interrupt, you can't hear their voice. So I'd add to that both space and safety. And one of the things that I notice of quietly powerful people is that or quietly powerful leaders, is that they create both safety and space very effectively. And that's what allows the whole team or the whole organization to have a voice. And so to me, that's very quietly powerful when that works well.
And I think one of Amy Edmondson, when she talks about psychological safety, she talks about those two elements. Mm. It's the environment you create as well as the culture that surrounds that environment. So the freedom to speak up, but also the environment where you can speak up and be yourself when you're doing it.
Jeff, I think that leads really well into our next long question. How has our understanding and appreciation of different leadership styles changed over the last 20 or 30 years, and what's driving that change?
Paul, this might be one that would be a useful one for you to kick us off on.
Thank you for that. I'm reflecting about when I started my management career. I was fortunate to work at Shell, which was global multinational company with a very, very well-developed management development education program for its leaders, current and emerging. And we explored a lot what leadership meant in those terms. And historically, there was, that element that you had to be tall and, sort of the military man archetype, if you like. And I think as we've found that the world is a distributed decision-making and increasingly, virtual team type world, the relational aspects about leadership and a team become more about being inclusive, and that any good idea comes from anywhere. So the sort of military strongman model, which I think is often exhibited in movies or, novels, is less useful to us when we're thinking about our virtual distributed team-based getting things done, whether you've got somebody who's in the Netherlands or somebody in Singapore. So that leadership style is, in my mind, leading to being a lot more about getting the best from a team and how you actually focus people's different contributions.
It's interesting you talk about the military style, because you could almost say it's like a control, power over, command and control, I suppose, is the stereotypical view of the military leader. And it's really interesting because I interviewed a military leader as part of writing the book, and he was the Rear Admiral of the Australian Navy. And he said, yes, I agree, that kind of military command and control style is absolutely necessary when you're on the field, but that's about 10% of the work. Mm. And he said, and he's also a quietly powerful leader, by the way, so it makes sense that he says this, but 80, 90% of the work is about planning, strategizing, getting the team on board and making sure they trust each other, trust the leadership directions when they need to. So that whole relational thing is just as important, if not more, so that when they're directive, people actually come along. So that, I thought that was very useful insight for me in flipping the idea. But what I find really interesting, though, is that I think we cognitively or intellectually understand that that sort of distributed or sharing power or power with kind of approach to leadership is more useful. But I still feel like we're emotionally attached to that heroic leadership style. And so we idolize or maybe just kind of put them on the pedestal when somebody is like in charge. And I think it requires both the leadership to shift, but also followership to shift as well, to really step into being empowered or feeling empowered.
Yeah. One of the, project management past life, if you will. One of the things that I focused on quite a lot was modifying the way we manage the operational environment through distributed planning and control, and making the people that actually are closest to doing the work responsible for planning and controlling their own work. And exactly as you're saying, Megumi, that the first challenge is getting senior managers to release the control. The second challenge is to get then people to accept control. And there's an element of trust that goes in that. Are you just setting me up to fail here? Or do you, once again, it's what you say versus what you do kind of thing. And but as people begin to trust, leaders trust their teams, and teams begin to trust their leaders are actually giving them those responsibilities. That's when people start to settle into those roles, and you get that sort of team environment where you're not just taking advantage of thinkers and doers, but the knowledge that comes from the work phase, or whatever work phase that may be.
Yes, I observed during a particularly high-profile corporate collapse I was involved in, and it really made me think about this notion that leadership can come from anywhere, as opposed to applying it to, you know, the head of a department or, you know, CEO or such like. And I observed in this mass trauma that occurred over a 48-hour period that some people stepped up, even though the positional authority didn't really require it, but as their personal capacity enabled them to do it. Other people in senior leadership roles for whom I had thought and assumed would, through the course of their career, be trained to deal with just the circumstance were in effect missing in action. They couldn't handle the series of events. So it really crystallized in my mind that leadership is a personal attribute of quality, and that it can emerge or disappear under the, you know, these different circumstances, and not to assume that senior executives in an organization actually have the capacity to be effective leaders because some aspect of their values or moral qualities just were found missing, or they just didn't know how to deal with this level of traumatic corporate collapse that was occurring and their staff being affected by it. I think that's probably enough that I want to say on that. It was a very revealing insight that leadership really emerges from anyone.
And in as we're talking about here today, in many ways, you know, you can lead with your skills and experience. You can lead with commitment and dedication. You can lead by lifting up people around you, and not have your hands directly on the steering wheel, so to speak. So, Mike, another question coming up, I trust.
We do, Jeff. Yes. So our next question is, how can business leaders benefit from giving their quieter staff an opportunity to be heard?
Well, I would just sort of say, step back. And I think, Jeff, you referred to it a little bit earlier. I mean, you have to give yourself, you have to have the awareness that your need for control exists. And to understand that that actually is not a dynamic that is being constructive or helpful for the team. So I think there is a point about stepping back and that you don't need to be the smartest person in the room. And if you are aware that you have that tendency, that's the first insight you need, but also to take the action to allow others in the room to be heard. So that, to me, is really probably the fundamental question is, you have to, as Megumi was saying before, provide space for other people to be heard, and it's not your ego needs that predominate here. You may, in fact, be counterproductive.
I would actually, I would add almost a question before this question, which is, what's the cost of not giving space to those quieter voices? Because if you think about all the disasters that's happened in organizations, you know, there were people who knew and they just didn't have the voice. And so if you're not listening to those voices, especially the voices that you don't perhaps want to hear or the ones that have gone quiet, it's a huge cost. So if you don't recognize that, then you won't make the effort. And so to me, that's question number one. And then the how is, I agree with Paula, stepping back and noticing how you might be behaving in a group, and whether that's squashing voices or whether it's inviting voices.
Megumi, in some of the interviews that you've done for your work, what are some of the benefits that people have expressed coming out of sort of that quieter approach to their leadership?
I can share with you some interviews that I did and surveys that I did with a quietly powerful leader, and I also spoke to their team members. And what they said, well, this was a senior leadership team, and their team said it's the best executive team they've ever worked in. And the reason is that the ideas were free flowing. So the leader would actually ask them, you know, with an idea, say, oh, I've got this idea, what do you think? And so everybody gets to input into that. And, you know, it's very clear sometimes the leader will have to make a decision, but they feel like they had input into it. And of course, the quality of listening is high, of course. But that sort of environment, you know, it does sort of link into psychological safety that we were talking about before. Mm-hmm. It enables people to feel empowered to bring their voice, but also it makes them feel like they can take on and go with their own ideas as well, because they feel empowered to have views and express views and so on. So I think that particular leadership team, the CIO has been on the top 10 CIO list for the last 5 years, so consecutively, and nobody else has done that. So it's evidence just from the external evidence, but also within the team.
Yeah, one of my hypotheses around this, you know, sort of the benefit side, is it's sort of two-pronged. You actually gain insights that you can't possibly get because you're insulated at, you know, in organizational hierarchies. You don't understand your customers because you're not in front of your customers, or you don't understand the operating floor because you're not out there operating things. But then, as you're alluding to, Megumi, you also get that engagement with your employees where they feel seen, and what they have to contribute has meaning and purpose. And so they're more eager then to share ideas, to share their insights, and be on the lookout for things that might improve the organization. So you get kind of this upward spiral of, mm-hmm. okay, I'm valued for what I do at the work face, and they're valued because what they do at the work face is something that a leader actually doesn't have access to as the head of an organization.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to follow up on that question Megumi raised about what is the cost of not doing it. And I'm reflecting on a couple of fairly high profile examples recently in the business press where the board fired their CEO because they were somewhat abusive or demanded too much, and the reputation of the business was suffering. So I feel there's a lot in this aspect about understanding the cost of leadership that doesn't enable the best of the team and the organization to be demonstrated. More and more, we're seeing a lot of the responses by, you know, commissions, boards taking decisions that this is not a viable or tenable approach anymore.
And it doesn't serve the environment we're in anymore. Yeah. It's moving too quickly. You can't afford to have things filter from the top of the organization down to the troops. Ideas need to start where it's going to be implemented, so you don't have this up and down thing going on.
And there's a lot of stress that CEOs feel that they are under. They've got very high performance KPIs. There's a lot of financial return and benefit as a result of that. So it does focus a lot of their attention on being quite ego-led. So it's a very nuanced capacity to be able to recognize that actually you will achieve that if you adopt a style that's a quieter leadership style.
Oh my goodness. I suspect this leads us into our next question. Mike, what do you think?
It's the perfect segue. We had wondered this ourselves in pre-production, but we've also had a question from the audience. What is quiet leadership?
I distinguish quiet leadership and quietly powerful leadership, because I think you can have quiet leadership where it's not effective. I've seen quiet leaders who don't say a lot, or they're a little bit aloof, or maybe they don't engage with people enough, and that's not necessarily powerful or effective to me. So what I have, the people who I interviewed were quietly powerful leaders because they were effective in their quietness, if that makes sense. Mm. And the effectiveness came from the listening and the engaging, and it wasn't about always being silent. It's not that. It's just a quieter approach to leadership. And the reason why it was effective, I actually talk about three attributes that I saw in these quietly powerful leaders, one of which was that they were very comfortable in themselves. So almost like what Paul was saying, if you're ego-driven, you may go into trying to dominate or get your ideas through and things like that. So because they're comfortable, they didn't feel the need to do so. So they're allowing others to engage, others to have a voice. They are comfortable to say they don't know everything. They are comfortable to be very authentic and say, well, you know, this is who I am. And so that engages people more readily. Also that they are, because they're comfortable, they can be very present with everybody because they don't have this little voice going, oh, what am I saying? And you know, all those little inner critics that we might have in our heads. They either have learnt to manage that or they just have this ability to switch on and be very present. And that allows for greater connection, and that also allows for deeper, meaningful relationships. And they are very good relationship builders. And then thirdly, that they're purposeful. What I found of these leaders, they're often not, that they haven't taken on leadership roles because they wanted to have the power or the control or the or the attention for that matter. They most of them have said, I never thought of myself as a leader, but they stepped into leadership because they saw that they can contribute something greater than themselves. And that, again, is going opposite to the ego-driven type of leadership. And to me, that was very powerful. So to me, that's quietly powerful leadership as opposed to just simply being quiet.
Excellent. Excellent distinction, I think, there. And Paul, surely as a board member, you've seen different leadership styles, and some, we'd hope that some of those would be those quietly powerful leaders that are recognizable.
Yeah. In fact, my view is a chair is more effective and therefore exerting quietly powerful attributes, as Megumi described, when they do manage a meeting and the people around the room effectively. Because in a boardroom, in effect, you're all equal. There isn't a leader beyond the chair. And collectively you make a decision. So you can't fall back on, you know, traditional hierarchies or status distinctions when you are actually in the room.
Hmm. Cool. And you know, once again, that distinction of being quietly powerful isn't that you're silent, it's that you speak in chosen ways, in purposeful ways. And I think asking a lot of questions
In my view, it's like, what is the problem we're trying to deal with? So you really are trying to put what's the issue on the table and take everyone's, you know, ego and need to dominate a conversation and focus on, you know, what's the purpose, what's the problem, how do we interpret it, whose angle is, you know, viewing it, sort of like the seven blind men and the elephant. You know, if I only know that an elephant's got a big foot, that's all I will see. So it's very important to be able to get that. You're bringing views onto the table from different perspectives and outlooks. And that to me is what quietly powerful leadership is about, is, you know, the better outcome for the organization.
Yeah. And the more powerful, or how, the more different than your own opinions and perspectives, the more powerful they are, because then you're adding new ingredients to the mix, so to speak. Cool. Mike, do we have more questions?
Of course we have more questions, Jeff. We always have more questions than time. In fact, speaking of the elephant in the room, I think this question follows on from that perfect segue. How has the work from home world of the pandemic begun to blur the lines between leadership style and personal style? Should we be talking less about style and focus, leadership style, and focus more on personal style?
I have to own up for this one. I was just struck that the first time ever in history, everyone experienced the same situation of working from home. I mean, that is remarkable. And we were all grappling with technology and all of the other aspects of people's lives, you know, taking, you know, dealing with the kids, the pets, the whatever. And it was so striking that a lot of the reporting in the business press was about, you know, CEOs of major corporations really learning about, I bring my whole person to work now, not the bit that I edit and let people see when I'm actually in the physical world of the office building. And it's very hard to, you know, maintain that persona when the cat walks across your keyboard, for example, or the dog's barking and, you know, the kid just walks through or things of that kind. And I just thought it was, you know, a wonderful period where all of those, my work face and my work persona just had to blur and melt away to incorporate the whole persona and the, you know, randomness of, you know, domestic and other, you know, parts of one's life. So it brought in my mind a question about the humanity of leadership and how we think about who, how we are bringing our, you know, authentic selves, to use a term, to the table and to the workplace, wherever that might be. So I was just struck by that as an amazing experience that everyone went through. It wasn't just the CEO's cat that needed to be let out or, you know, their subordinates. So we had this wonderful meshing and blurring of lives.
Yeah, I agree. Sorry, Jeff. Me. Yeah,
no.
I agree. I love the sort of connection we had as just human beings, regardless of rank. And, you know, I think I saw a post on LinkedIn one time where people came in as their Zoom selves. So they came in with their, you know, beautiful tops and their pajama bottoms or something like that, you know, and that was from all sorts of different hierarchies. So I think that that becoming human is fantastic. And in a way, it's a great transition that occurred or is occurring around shifting from like a machine-like organization to a human organization. I think that is such an important shift that we should be making and are making, and hope we can continue on that path, because I think that machine-like organization is driving people to burn out and not think about the human cost, all of those things. I think it's a really important shift that we're making.
And there's so much in this one. I believe that that machine-like organization, the corporate factory, just doesn't work anymore.
Yeah.
Aside from what it does to the people in the organization, it just is not, it's not the sort of organization you need to deal with the sort of environment you have to now operate in. Mm-hmm. It is a more organic environment, so you better have an organization that is more organic. And the humanity of leadership is such a beautiful terminology, because it's not just being human as a leader, but recognizing that you are leading humanity. Mm-hmm. And all of those things, you know, they come with an administrative load, but humans are the things that make our business world move forward. And we saw it in the pandemic. We didn't, you know, all the machines didn't shut down. The robots didn't stop working. It was a very human problem that brought the business world grinding to a halt, and a human problem that we needed to solve. Mm. Mike, we're way through a lot of questions.
We are. We're getting through some really powerful questions today too. There's a great question here that's come from the audience from Gillian Woon. Any suggestions apart from, say, pre-warning to the chairs or you know, preparation for trying to engineer a space for quieter people to provide their helpful views, especially in a room full of more vocal, powerful people? I think I'm going to reread that, because I want to say more vocal, powerful people. I don't want to put the emphasis on the wrong syllable there.
So really is that that idea of how do we create, you know, create space as leaders for quieter people to express themselves that you were talking about earlier, Megumi.
Mm-hmm.
Any
there's definitely the pre-warning, in fact, I think if you have a good chair or facilitator, it makes a massive difference. So I think Paula talked about that in a board context, that, you know, if she's chairing, she makes sure that different voices are heard. So I think that's a very important role that, that the chair or facilitator plays. And often the if you have a quieter person chairing or facilitating, they notice the quieter people more, I find. So I think that's quite an interesting consideration if you are appointing a chair or facilitator. But also there's other, and this will depend on the type of group setting that you have, but I've heard about things like brainstorming can be really tiring or very difficult for quieter people to, you know, think on the spot and contribute on the spot and things like that. So some and often that doesn't actually generate the best ideas. So it can be helpful to do individual brainstorming first and then do a group brainstorming, for instance, or get the post-it notes out and get people to think individually and then share. In fact, Brené Brown talks about that, where you don't want people listening to the group ideas and just going into groupthink. So it might actually be better to write things down and then turn over the card or whatever you've written it down on all together, because then you get diversity of views because people haven't been coloured by other people's views. So there's a whole bunch of different ways like that that draws on the different perspectives, which I think is really helpful.
Absolutely.
It's very rare for me to. It's very rare for me to actually want to contribute to a point here because I'm. But as a quiet person, I feel quite inspired by that, and just motivated by thinking about the way that people move slowly into an opinion or move, you know, in a considered fashion to an opinion. They might have something to say later. And not expecting them to do it now is kind of it's an outcome of our, you know, education, which requires us to think on the spot. You know, to get into law school in the US, for example, you have to go through this ridiculous exam that requires you to think really fast about really complicated things. Are they the best answers possible? No, maybe not. Probably because not. But they're the fastest. Does that make them the best? No, it doesn't. So, but considering that those things might come later, is really important, you know, for me to hear that other people are going to value that, hopefully, as a result of this discussion.
Well, I think that's very much talked about in Daniel Kahneman's work, the books Thinking Slow, Thinking Fast and Slow. So they talk about, he talks about the two modes of thinking and how it can be dangerous to do too much fast, immediate thinking, particularly when you're trying to solve complex problems. Because what happens if you do fast thinking, you're basing it on past experience, all the biases and values and things that you hold, rather than really thinking from a different angle, bringing in different voices and really thinking it through. And, you know, that system two thinking, he calls it, that slower thinking is necessary in an uncertain, complex, unpredictable world. So I do think that's what you bring up, Mike, is really important.
I'd like to explore a little bit of the underpinning assumption in this question. I think we've got some practical suggestions that, you know, pre-warning and this example that Megumi came up with, which are, you know, means by which you can ensure a range of views are heard. I think there is also the responsibility of the quieter person to undertake experiments with themselves in these types of settings, to in effect step out of, you know, a comfort zone into a discomfort zone and almost give themselves little experiments to say, in this meeting I'm going to speak, or in this meeting I'm going to speak three times. And I think until you actually decide that you are going to take some steps yourself, as well as all of the other, you know, practical aspects, because, you know, part of it is a purpose of providing a point of view. It's not about yourself, it's about a point of view to be able to contribute for the better solution or decision or conversation that's being held. So I would encourage people less to focus on, you know, that they haven't got the space, but what's the purpose of the point of view? And that may just take down the anxiety level a little and focus more on the outcome rather than the, you know, the self in this way, and almost to give oneself little experiments to, you know, focus on as a way of creating that opportunity to speak more in addition to the practical things that you've outlined.
That's a great point, Paula. I think it's both the individual and the facilitator chair and the group giving the space. And yeah, I agree. If you focus on the purpose, or I often talk about shifting the attention from me to we. So rather than focusing on, you know, how am I going to sound? Is this going to be a silly thing to say? What are they going to think of me? They're all me focused concerns. If you can shift that to, well, what am I adding to, what's useful in for this group right now, then you become more purposeful, as you say, and you can actually add things. And I think challenging yourself to do that is really important.
I think there's a follow-up question here from Gillian. Sorry, Jeff, there's a follow-up just question here about how to change the usual dynamics in these types of meetings. And I think you're just starting to touch on that. But if I could ask the panel again, how do you change the usual dynamic that exists in these kinds of meetings to actually facilitate this?
So is this from the individual's perspective, or it didn't really say?
I think the usual team dynamics is what I gathered from.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. Well, I think the first thing is the awareness, I would have thought, just to realise that dynamic is working or not working. If it's not working, then just to recognise that and see, well, what needs to shift. So I think that will be the first step. And then I think, as we've been talking about, it takes both the group, the facilitator or the chair, and the individuals themselves to all really shift in some way. You know, it doesn't shift by shifting one little piece. Having said that, I think when individuals start to make an effort, it does start to shift, because people would start to see you saying something useful and go, oh, okay, we need to listen to her. And that's what some of the quietly powerful leaders have said, actually, where they started to challenge themselves. And actually, one of them said that they asked themselves questions and then try and answer that in the room, so that they actually think of something to say that's useful in the context of the conversation. So challenging themselves, and that got people listening to them more so as well.
I mean, at the end of the day, there's also people whose motivations are not pure,
you reckon?
So you know, these are all terribly important, practical, and you know, important steps individually and as a team and a leader to take. However, and it's always, I think, disappointing when you find that you've been operating on the assumption that everyone's, you know, in this together, we're all in this together, and you find that really some motivations that people have, either overtly and consciously or unconsciously, are not about that at all. They are actually their need for power and control, you know, is what drives them, as opposed to, you know, achievement or affiliation or, you know, getting the best out of people. So as much as it's hard to admit, not everyone else in the world necessarily shares your views and may be operating, you know, with completely different agendas that absolutely trip you up. And it's an unfortunate experience in organisational life that you will come across people whose motivations aren't pure. And in fact, there's probably not much you can do about it, nor is it really worth spending a lot of emotional and intellectual thought, time and energy about it. But just to recognise you'll come up against, you know, some unpleasant characters along the way. I'm not sure if that helps with your conversation at all.
But it certainly is truth. And look, we're getting close to, well, we are at the top of the hour and past our time, but I just want to add one final thought to this conversation. And Megumi touched on, when you recognize that there is a dynamic you need to fix, the first step is intention. Okay, I'm going to be intentional, and that comes from the leader. I'm going to be intentional about modifying this dynamic. And then there's practice. You don't do it because you say one day, okay, suddenly we're going to be open and our quieter people are going to be jumping in. And the people that always want to dominate the conversation are going to hold back. You have to keep doing it. You don't step onto a golf course and pick up a golf club for the first time and expect to play par golf. You have to keep doing it. And as you do it, you'll get better. And as I think you alluded to, Megumi, people will then see, oh, these other people that haven't said very much actually have something to add to the conversation. And I don't have to dominate, you know, me as a dominant personality doesn't have to dominate the conversation the whole time. And then, of course, touching on your point, Paul, as somebody wise once said to me, if you can't change the people, then change the people if they become absolutely disruptive. So I think we should wrap up. I want to be mindful of our audience's time. I want to be mindful of our panelists' time. So just couple minutes, final thoughts on our discussion today. Megumi, would you like to share sort of your thoughts around this chat?
I've enjoyed chatting about both the practical and the sort of deeper meanings of, you know, leadership, and the particularly around shifting towards that human leadership. And I think that's such an important shift that we're making. And part of that is about really listening to what's going on, listening to people, listening to yourself. So I think if we can do more of that, which is a quietly powerful leadership skill, if you like, if we can do more of that and really appreciate each other for who they are and who they're becoming, then I think we'll create better organizations and a better world, hopefully.
Excellent. Thank you, Megumi. Paula, closing thoughts?
Well, that's pressure.
I know.
Yes, I think there's a personal responsibility in this, and there's also a shared responsibility, and it is a dance between the two. We're certainly, if you're in a leadership space, your responsibility to get the best out of the people that you're working around and with. And there's also, I think, a personal responsibility as the individual to bring your game. You know, and it's not necessarily always going to be easy to find a way to push through the brambles of interference so that your voice is heard. So it is, I think, a dance between the me and the we. And practically, it's every little moment at a time. Focus on the now and the immediate little steps rather than try to change the game, you know, in a day, in a meeting, etc. So that's probably what I would do.
Absolutely. Beautiful. That, well, very well said. Mike, closing thoughts from you?
Well, Jeff, it's been a ride today. I mean, from that incredibly emotional start at the top, which I knew was coming, but affected all of us nonetheless. And to really looking at some, I've enjoyed the practical applications, the moments to think and the considerations that we can bring. I have one last very, very brief question for anyone who wants to answer it about how to get from resources like yourselves more practical applications for quietly powerful leadership. Just, you know, if you've got a book, this is the chance to spruik it.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you. Yes, I do have a book. So the book is called Quietly Powerful, How Your Quiet Nature is Your Hidden Leadership Strength. And of course, I've got books, programs, and I do one-on-one coaching and things like that. Thank you for giving me the space to say that. I didn't tweak a bit
slower. You were primed to answer the question, and I was just feeding you the... There you are.
Excellent. So with that, we will wrap up. And I just want to close by saying the thing that really has stuck with me here is the humanity of leadership comment and how much that can and does mean in this conversation that we just had. That's one that I'm for sure going to take away and explore more broadly and deeply. But I want to say thank you very much for the time and attention of our audience, the time and attention of our panelists. It is our most valuable commodity, so I never undervalue how what a gift it is when you provide it to us. So thank you for that. And for the audience out there, or the would-be audience, if you will, our next show will be on the 7th of April. So please join us for the next Difference Project. And until then, thank you, and go out there and make a difference.